time of change. This is the sound of redemption. This is the way that we bring it down. Down, down, 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 down. Igniting the fire within you. Exalting the melody of freedom. These are the things that will bring it down.
Stereotyped, please don't even show up. Good morning, Mr. Jenkins.
Good morning.
That message, brother.
Eric.
Don't even show up. I mean, look, we are in, well, I've always said, right, that we have been at war, or this country has been at war with black folks since the first African was brought here and enslaved. They tried to sell us on the fact that we were in a post-racial America. But more and more, we're starting to understand what the truth is and the fact that they lied to us. And so we need people who are running for political office, who are prepared to stand on the front line and fight. So like, you know, like Congresswoman Presley said, we don't need black folks who don't want to have a black voice. That's what I'm saying. Now, if you're part of the LGBTQ community, you shouldn't want to have an LGBTQ person who doesn't have your voice.
Right.
Right? And so everybody should have, but we've been, again, sold a bill of goods that having black faces in these places meant that we had representation.
Well, we just chose wrong. I mean, you know, it is important to have, you know, as we say, black faces in those places. But we just chose wrong. You know, someone said something yesterday. I'm in one of those moods today.
I know.
You could tell when the mood.
Please share the show, guys.
Someone
said something.
They always want to give us the sprinkles, but not the cake. You know, or, you know, another person said this weekend, it was really interesting. And I'll tell you about the sprinkles and the cake analogy. Someone else talked about, you know, us being a club, the American descendant of slaves, learning what being a club really means. It was a great discussion because we're so all over the place and we've been so watered down by so many variables. You know, if it's immigration, if it's black immigration, black Americans really don't have a club, and we don't know how to protect the club, and we don't know how to tell people that you ain't welcome in the club. It's just like the informed class. Like, it takes, you know, to be informed and to be a part of that class, I take that seriously because I know we do the work. We listen. We're open to diverse conversations. It might be uncomfortable, but we're open to them.
Right.
And the informed class are people that are willing to learn and evolve and grow, even if it makes them have to take a different position than what they did years ago, because you're exploring this in such a deeper way. But the other thing that I heard this weekend, because, you know, I listen to black radio. I don't even watch TV because black radio is so authentic and they're really smart people. And one of the people were saying, I think I might be redundant, but we don't kick them off the island. Like bad leadership, like, you know, bad black leaders, whatever they are, we keep them on the island knowing we should kick them off. Like, we should kick them off the island. Like,
but I don't think we know that we should kick them off.
I know
that we've been conditioned.
Yeah, that's what he was saying, actually.
Yeah, we have been conditioned to have this level of confusion between cultural pride and accountability.
Yeah, so he was...
We're just happy to have black people in office.
Yeah, he was...
Right? Or black people around. And then, you know, we say that that is the end goal. That the end goal isn't that we attain anything. It is simply that we can say we have a black mayor, or we have a black governor, or we have a black congressman, or we have a black senator, or we've got a, you know, the first black person to work at IBM. But what does that have to do with our collective advancement? Nothing. And so we get comfortable with that. And then, you know.
I love it. I think we should start kicking people off the island.
You know? Well, we need to hold them accountable is what need to do.
Well, we tried that already.
Right.
We tried that already. We tried to hold them accountable. You got elected to do a job. You said this is what you were going to do. And, you know, I don't even know if we waste our time on that anymore. I just think that a lot of them need to be kicked off the island.
Well, what does that mean?
Kicking them off the island?
Yeah.
Well, kicking them off the island means something really well. Get them out of leadership. Get somebody in.
All right. Well, that's what I'm saying.
But you got to kick them off the island. You can't. I don't want to interpret what they did in the last. They're done.
Oh no! But I just want to be clear. Like, we're not moving
them
to someplace else.
We're rid of them.
Right. We're moving them out of the way.
Yeah.
Right. Marginalized.
Yeah. Like,
as
bye.
Opposed to exalting.
Yeah, like bye. Like, yeah. I can't say what I really want to say. Bye.
But,
you know,
but
it's just what it is. I mean, and you see the remnants of it. And I think, you know, I didn't know what you wanted to leave with today, but I was fascinated. I was fascinated by this whole Donald Trump thing this weekend. about Baltimore. Because I think on the show, you and I and all of us have said, all of the hosts have said, look, we know that Trump is very, he is a racist.
He's a racist.
He represents the corporation of white supremacy. He's a demagogue.
Unabashedly.
Unabashedly.
He got
a club member.
Right, yo, a carrying member.
You know, I find it fascinating because
I'm just shocked that he hasn't put a hood on his head. But I'm telling you, Kevin, I am shocked that he hasn't, and it may come to that, that he actually comes adorned with the whole, you know.
We've seen this before, 1943, fascism, communism, you know, Nazism. We've seen all this language before. We've seen, you know, genocide and Sudan. We've seen it all before. So mm-hmm. I'm not, like, in shock by any of this. It's just that, you know, he's an original gangster. He's, like, cold-blooded in your face. I'm telling you, this is what we really feel about you. Mm-hmm. And
right.
What you going to do about it?
Mm-hmm.
What you going to do about it? You ain't going to do nothing about it. You're going to go back to your neighborhoods. You're going to complain to each other. You're going to drink the dirty water. You're going, yeah, I'm talking about you. I'm saying that your leaders ain't crap. And I'm saying, look, here I am, a guy from New York. You know, I'm from their class, and I'm telling you what they really say.
Right.
See, everybody keeps
what he said in 2016,
yeah,
right?
What did he say? What they really say about
he said, you all have been living in crappy conditions.
Right.
Vote for me. What do you have to lose?
Yeah.
That's what he said in 2016.
Here's the thing. His crappy people, or the people that voted for him, I find very interesting. It's just brilliant because they don't care about their money. They don't care about their station. They care about their privilege.
Right.
And they're voting for him for their white privilege.
Right.
And I get that. Mm-hmm. I understand. They have a club.
Mm-hmm.
And they got the most, they have the meanest person on earth to be, you know, the leader
fighting
of their club,
them.
Fighting for them, whether mm-hmm. you like it or not. They say, oh, it's fake news. If he says it's fake news, it's fake news.
Right.
If he says, you know, I mean, it's just fascinating. But when our club is so watered down.
We don't have a club.
We don't. I know. You're
okay. We don't.
I know.
We don't have a club.
Eric,
Carrie, we don't
know,
have a club.
I know. We don't have a club.
We don't have a club.
So, all right. Okay, so listen.
That's why we're over there with them.
Yeah, we over everywhere.
Somebody.
Oh, everywhere. We embrace everybody, you know. And right. then, so I was trying to make.
What they say, it's un-American for us to have a club.
Oh, it's un-American. And right. we let anybody in. I mean, just because they have black skin, right. he must be conscious about, you know, who we are. And we made a mistake, and we have to go back and rethink that. And I think that's uncomfortable for, not for me to say, but it's uncomfortable for people to get
it. I want
to
ask you a question.
That's funny.
Because I'm listening to the news talk about Donald Trump being a racist, Donald Trump being a racist. I want to try to shift the narrative for a second. America is racist.
Yeah.
So, right. So it's not about Donald Trump being a racist. America is a racist. America.
But you know what that's about.
Right.
It's about using the liberal press to give a definition and make us look this way. Remember we talked last week?
Right.
They always got us looking over here at that.
But America is a racist.
Yeah, America is racist. America is racist.
Right.
It is. America is racist.
Right. And so, again, when we
keep
saying here,
it.
Getting rid of Donald Trump is not going to stop America from being racist.
Look. I think everybody
and all of the people who now are talking about, oh, get rid of Donald Trump, they were complicit. They've been complicit in advancing America's racism. All of them. You haven't heard, Kevin, you haven't heard them speaking out like they're speaking out now.
No, they haven't.
Right? And America was as racist 2 years ago as it is now.
No, what it is, see, they let that caged animal out. See, that caged animal was out there. He's exposed all of them. And you have to see them on TV. Morning Joe was like, I had to turn it off because they couldn't even explain what it was. It was embarrassing. I think really, to be honest with you, I think it's time for them to move on. I mean, the way he tried to wrap it up into his Bible Belt beliefs and how, you know, his church went and helped the needy and Mika with her privilege. But, you know, talking about, well, Donald Trump is a horrible person. And then you had the black poverty managers, you know, the guys that work for the oligarchs, the black people,
mm-hmm.
they're up there saying, you know, he's repugnant, he's this, he's that, he's this, he's this. I'm saying to myself, that show has to end. Because it's to the point now, even their maximum sophisticated confusion is not even working. It's ridiculous. Here's the deal. We already identified that he's a racist. Okay. We already identified that Russia interfered with the election. But guess what? you've been interfering with the elections too for many, many years.
Absolutely.
Micro-targeting, you know, propaganda. Because what that's what you're doing on your show. See, people got to get a little bit more sophisticated. That show is about propaganda. It's not about reporting news and analyzing information. It's a propaganda show. So every day you get up in the morning from 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock is propaganda. And then what he's doing is he's they're taking that small group of people and they're working them just like, you know,
just like Fox Russia News
did.
Does.
Just like Russia did. Mm-hmm. They took the persuadables. Mm-hmm. They're trying to get the persuadables to think the way they do. So it's the same thing. So what Russia did is the same thing that Hillary Clinton and them did in Russia 4 years prior.
Absolutely.
And that's why Putin said, I'm going to get you. I'm going to get you, right? So it's all maximum sophisticated confusion. But the little person, they don't know that. The little person doesn't understand that. They bring Reverend Barber on, and he says, I went down to the border. They bring on this other person and says, deplorable. And so I'm saying to myself, how do you reconcile that lie? I mean, that situation is horrible. Nothing should happen to those children. Those women should be protected at the border.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is a human crisis. Yeah. But come on, folks.
Yeah.
Come on now. Come on. Enough is enough. And now. Come on, folks.
And now with Donald Trump talking about Baltimore.
Come on. Wait.
Right.
You want to spend a couple of minutes on that?
And so.
Come on, folks.
Simple question.
Maximum sophisticated confusion.
Kevin, how many murders were in Baltimore last year?
300 and some odd murders.
About 314 murders.
But we got to put it in context. Can we put Baltimore in context?
Let's put it in context.
Baltimore is a pro-typical black city.
Mm-hmm.
It has black legislators. It has had black mayors. It has had black councils. Right? It was the epicenter of redlining. That's where it all began. Right? Redlining began right there in Baltimore. That's where it all started. They were the epicenter of it. So we got 50 years of all of that. That stuff, redlining, you know, police brutality, you know, high underemployment. I mean, the highest underemployment in the country, one of them. They're up there with NORC, 300 and some odd murders. So if they got 300 and some odd murders with 550,000, NORC has 100 and something murders per capita, they're about the same. You know what I mean? Per capita. So, but it took Trump to get all of them to have a press conference to defend their honor and to defend their city. That was.
Well, what were they defending?
They weren't defending anything. What they were trying to do is do what we've been saying for the longest: use Trump as a distraction from the present reality in Baltimore.
Right.
See, that's what it was. I mean, but average person doesn't know that. They just get they look at the redheaded racist, you know, the big guy. Say you got rat infested places. Then all of a sudden. Rat-infested became a narrative. Then he said...
Racist.
Cummings said... then everybody went to defend Cummings. Now, let's talk about this for a second. Cummings has been in the Congress for years. Clyburn in the Congress for years. We had just had a black mayor for black president for 8 years. So if you look at the black congressional leaders
mm-hmm.
and measure that to what the white congressional leaders bring to their people in their districts... It's like this, night and day.
Well, with the exception of Mitch McConnell. And Kentucky is bad.
Yeah, but
it's horrible.
No, white Kentucky is great. Black Kentucky is bad. Now, you see what I'm trying to say to you?
Right.
Okay, so let's put that in context, too. So now they got us over there looking at this guy when 50 years of black leadership, I mean, black electeds, 50 years. Now, I'm trying to make a point. Cummings and those guys sit on Congress, right?
Mm-hmm.
Congress appropriates money, right? Congress is the one that puts bills up to spend money in cities, right? Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen an infusion in the cities? You haven't seen an infusion in cities since Bill Clinton.
Right.
So what is Cummings upset about? He was right. He was like, yo, my man, before you keep talking about me every day, keep saying my name every day, all right, you've identified who I am. Go clean up your mess.
Right.
I mean, that's what I would say it.
And the thing is, are we denying that? So he's been in Congress since 1996.
My God.
So what's that? 2006, 16, almost 24 years the guy has been in Congress.
Come on. I mean, but you
see. But this is what we're talking about when you say we need to kick him off the island.
Yeah, kick
right?
him off the island.
So instead of folks looking and saying, you know what? Yeah, I'm not keen on the messenger, right? I've identified him as a racist and all that stuff, whatever. But the message, is the message true? Kids, and then here's the question. Why would you want folks living in that, in those conditions? And I'm inclined to agree with him. Nobody wants to live there. People live there because they can't move anywhere else. If they could move someplace else, I would bet that they would, if they had the financial wherewithal to
relocate. Well, they've had.
And who's the guy who cried, Kevin?
Oh, I got to get back to that. Give me 1 second. I talk about the tears. The tears.
You remember?
Oh, that was the funny. I was like, dude. Oh, come on, man. Come on. But let me just get that. She took me off track.
I'm sorry, Kevin.
That's all right. So I was fascinated by the outrage, the fake outrage. Say what I really want to say as far as the outrage is concerned, but it's fake outrage.
Right.
Now they're having a press conference talking about working with banks to deal with the home ownership. No, the average family in Baltimore has probably $100 to their names. $100. And this has been going on for 50 years. The 2006-2009 meltdown, right? Probably wiped them out even more, right?
Mm-hmm.
But none of these people did anything while that was going on.
Right.
None of them. Cummings goes around. He spends all of his time. You ever watch him? He is the biggest Uncle Tom in America. No, first of all, we got to stop saying Uncle Tom because people don't know in the book Uncle Tom was different.
Right.
I got to stop saying that word. But he's the biggest poverty manager of them all. So you can't use Uncle Tom anymore. I got to explain that in another show. But think about it. Think about what he's always talking about. We can do better than that. America is great. Oh, my God. Donald Trump's horrible. We have to investigate him. But he's not doing anything in that district, right, to promote excellence. He's not doing anything to reverse the tide of poverty. He hasn't done anything. And you have all of these people, all of these guard dogs for the Democratic Party defending him.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a Democrat. That's number one. I've been involved in community economic development all my life. When you will it, it gets done. When you're on a Congress, it gets done. When you appropriate, you do it. So you have a Democratic Congress. When Obama got there, didn't do anything but got in his way, whatever he was trying to do. And then you have a Democratic Congress right now. So what they should be doing instead of fighting against Trump or impeaching him, they should be appropriating money to the cities. But with a vision, not going to opportunity zones. That's not appropriate.
Well, Trump just threw something out there, though, which I'm waiting to see. Trump's talked about the money that's going to Baltimore and alluded to the notion that there may be thievery.
Oh, I don't know about that. But guess what? You have a world-class hospital out there that's just, wait a minute, though. I'm just telling you what they said. We get that same story here, too.
Right.
We got a world-class hospital that is just starting to gentrify, because that's what they're doing, gentrifying Baltimore. Because
I was going to say, how's it helping those indigenous?
It's not helping those people at all.
Mm-hmm.
They have some of the worst schools in America, right? They have, as far as black small business, I'm so sick and tired of people. There is no such thing as a black small business. Is there such thing as a business holding on for their dear life? There's a small, because when you say black small business or black business, I instantly think struggle and a waste of time. Because if you can't get access to capital, right, and if you can't get access to capital for a number of years before you start paying down that debt, you're done. And if your community doesn't have disposable income, you're finished.
So, you know, do you believe, well, my hope is, and I'm not sure if Cummings is up for re-election.
They'll elect him again.
But it would be nice to see him primary.
They don't like to kick people off the island.
But it would be nice to see him primary. I mean, what did we have in the Bronx? We had the third top-ranking Democrat who was kicked off the island.
Yeah, but you had a group of new people. You had a new, you have to understand what happened in AOC's territory, too, her district territory, her district. There was a group of new people coming in, young people like her, that got together and worked to make that happen. And Baltimore, as you can see, you saw the councilman that got up and spoke yesterday.
Well, but
I mean, when I'm just saying, I heard this young guy speaking.
Yeah, but
like, well, God, doggy, what did you get this guy from?
But the thing that I understand is this: when you look at the voting demographic in Baltimore, right, they're not a tremendous amount of people who vote for Cummings. And it is a generational thing, too, given
true.
The fact that he's almost been there 20 years. There are people my mother's age are voting for him. Younger people are not voting. And so to have a conversation, to have Justice Democrats move in there and begin to have a conversation with the younger folks, and then using as examples, you know, their support of Ilhan Omar, their support of Rashida Tlaib, and say to them, hey, look, you see what's happening in the Bronx with AOC. You need leadership like that that's gonna have your voice, that's gonna push. I think it has an there's an opportunity to motivate those young people, because they're not gonna vote for Cummings. I don't care what happens, they're not gonna vote for him. They'll either stay home, like they have been, or they'll come out and vote. Yeah. So you'll have a generational divide. But when you now have front and center on national news, Kevin, you know, the plight of Baltimore, and then you have these older, because look, you don't see any young people coming out and defending Baltimore. You see all these old guard dogs coming out and defending Baltimore. And what I really think they're doing is defending Cummings' seat and not showing that there's blood in the water and opportunity to unseat him. That's what I believe. I think that if they didn't come out and do this and they allowed it to roll over, and I think that they don't want this to go, you know, too much longer in the news cycle. They want to come out. They want to wash it clean, and they want to say, see, we came out, we defended him, everything is good, let's move on.
Well, you got Al Sharpton, you got Al Sharpton there.
Yeah.
You got the former Republican chair of the National Republican Party there.
Isn't that crazy?
They're all there standing up there talking about what, I don't know.
But
I mean, it's embarrassing.
But I'm telling you, if it goes, when did it, today is Monday, Saturday, I think. Was it Saturday or Friday that he,
I think it was Friday.
That he made the tweet, right? So Friday into Saturday, it dominated the news on Sunday, and now they're holding a press conference on Monday.
The second one,
right? I'm telling you, Kevin, if it goes two more days, they're in trouble.
Well, they brought
some
money.
If this thing gets
man.
Legs for two more days, now you're talking 7 days in the news, you're going to start getting those young people, because they're living the experience, Kevin. They're living the rat infested.
300-some-odd murders. Right? You have the worst schools in America, some of the worst schools in America. It sounds familiar? You have some of the worst infrastructure in the country. And he's on TV, Cummings on TV, talking about Trump every day. And this is what Trump was saying. Man, I would do the same thing. I know you can't be talking about me. Well, let's take a ride through your community. It's like this. Well, you should be appropriating money to fix that. Right. I'm the president. I don't appropriate money.
Right.
Now I sign off on it. See, people don't know government.
But here's the question.
People don't know government, though. People really don't know how this works.
Right.
You know, so it ain't the president saying, I'm going to give money. No, it's the Congress coordinating with the office of the president to appropriate money or getting it. You know,
but let's assume it was the president, Kev. How long has Donald Trump been in office?
2 years.
2 years. How long has Baltimore been the way it looks?
50 now.
And now how long has Cummings been in office?
24
years almost?
And nothing's changed.
Right. So he's been there for 24 years.
And he put him
and he wants to blame a guy who's been in office for 2 years. For commenting about what his district looks like. And then they want to turn around and say that it was racist.
See, this is where we fall short. We already identified that he's a racist. No racist tendencies. Trump's a racist. Okay. Done that. Now let's talk about the construct of racism that we've been living under. And these guys have been supposed to be leading us to at least move away from that or build our communities. They haven't done anything. They haven't done one thing. So I am non-emotional about that. If you lived in America long enough, you understand that they're racist in this country. You understand that there's a movement across the world to integrate nationalism, which means racism, which means illiberalism, which means all. I know that to be true. You know that, mm-hmm. right? But I have to deal with the black condition, and I'm not emotional. I don't get emotional about none of that stuff. I'm like, oh, he said it. Okay, well, he's just you know what club he's a part of. Now, what club are we a part of? So, what club are we a part of, Eric? You know what part? We purchase poverty propaganda. You see those guys out there this morning in the press conference. Talking about, we got to do better. And then they're talking about, I got some banks. We're going to do some small loans from banks. And we got to help black business. When are they going to change that?
We have no club.
It's disgusting.
But our
they're disgusting.
Our black electeds have decided to be a part of their club. They're not a part of our club. They're part of their club. But they're honorary members. They're not like full fledged members.
They don't let them in the club.
No.
I told you, they don't have to let them in the club because they have the purple phone. I told you about the purple phone. I keep trying to tell you about the purple phone. But listen, so now he says Baltimore is this. He can say Norcistus. He can say, see, that this is why.
Oh, but they did it.
They did it.
You didn't hear Biden's clap back to Corey?
No, I didn't.
Corey came at Biden about, you know, his 94 crime bill. And Biden came back and said, wait a minute, if Corey wants to talk about that, then we could talk about Newark.
Right.
That's what Biden said. He said, we could talk about Newark, and we could talk about all the black kids that, you know, were stopped and frisked under your watch. See, the corporation white supremacy has receipts, Karen.
Yeah, that's true.
They got receipts.
But I want to know, I really want to know how the informed class feels about this whole, this discussion that's going on between, you know, what he said about Cummings in Baltimore, and was it the truth? And was it really true? I mean, really, was it the truth? And I'm really fascinated because I see people caping for Cummings. You know, oh, Cummings, he's a great human being. Oh, he did nothing for Baltimore. If you drop, wait a minute, you go to Baltimore right now, you outside of the harbor with Mayor Smolch, his name is right, Mayor Smolch. I knew him. I mean, I think he was the first black mayor for Baltimore.
Right.
We got to know him at the National League of Cities, right? So he pioneered a lot of that growth, right? And then they've had like four mayors since then that did nothing. They've had black congressmen. I think, but here's the deal. They have a white governor, right? But they're saying that the governor is not really giving his full support to Baltimore. Well, then you take your 85% that vote for him and vote him out, right? It's all con job.
I mean, I would like to know.
Psychobabble.
I would like to know from the informed class, and I'm going to put the question up here. And
we will defend. We will defend these people. I find it fascinating. I wasn't the least bit insulted by what Trump said because I know where Trump comes from. I know who he is. Okay, we've identified that already. How long are we going to be distracted by that red-haired guy when we got some of the most important or pending crises that are impacting us? I think it's a joke. And when I see people like Al Sharpton and all of them defending Cummings, no, what they're really defending are themselves and their mediocrity.
Well, they defend themselves, they're defending their mediocrity, and they're defending his seat because they get something in return.
Yeah.
So for them, but none of what they're defending has anything to do with those 314 families that suffered last year because...
Well, you see every time that Cummings has the gavel, he's always crying.
Right.
We could do better. This is America. We could do better. I'm so sick of it. Listen, don't get me wrong. I cry.
Do you?
I cry. I know people think I don't have. You know, they think I don't have. They think
you're heartless.
They think I'm heartless, but I'm not actually. If my friends in the feed, no. There's certain things that will move me.
Okay.
Like I hate violence, you know, shit like that. But you ever follow Cummings? Every time he's making a statement, he's crying, he's tearing up. We could do better. When I see a black man like that in the middle of a war, we're in the middle of a war.
But
wait a minute, don't just say we're in the middle of a war.
Understand again? Yeah, who's he appealing to?
I know
he's appealing to people my mother's age, Kevin.
No, actually, he's giving a signal to the corporation, white supremacy, that we's okay. I got this.
Right, but he's not appealing to young people. They don't care.
We could do better.
They don't care.
This is America. What America is he telling me? We could do better. That's why, if I was a young person, I would be like this. You know, where's the drugs? That's like, if you're a young person, you hear that lie all the time. It must be painful for you to be sitting in your chair after graduating from college and hearing Cummings. And then you see the CNN reporter. Oh, my God. Oh, Lord. Oh, Jesus Christ. Did you see that CNN reporter? He gets up there. He starts, you know, doing his little thing, you know, setting up the show. And then all of a sudden, in the middle of the show, he does like, but I come from Baltimore. And I'm like, oh, come on. He's not crying because he was assaulted. He's not crying because, you know, he just finished a fight. He's crying to appeal to a certain class of people. Right. And you know what his feed was saying? Oh, he was brave for doing that. I mean, on TV crying. Be a man. I was one of those kids when I went off to college. Oh, please.
But you know what part of it is this, Kev?
Oh, cry me a river. I know what he was doing. He was trying to get a raise.
You know, but part of it is this. And we have an issue with it. It's just like when we had a white co-host on the show.
Oh, yeah, right.
And there were countless people who expressed to me personally the level of discomfort they felt when he called black people trifling.
Yeah, right.
Or when he called the streets in our hoods dirty. When he did those things, they felt uncomfortable about them. They were dirty. There are people who are trifling. But there's a belief that our dirty laundry shouldn't be aired out for everybody. That somehow we as black people should be talking about our issues and not putting them out there for white people to talk about them. I got a problem with that. Well, if you're embarrassed about the way that your conditions are, then clean them up. If you're embarrassed about the way that your street is, then clean it up. Right? But to believe that some white person shouldn't be able to talk about the fact that you live in filth, or that you send your kids in the factories of death, or that you wash your free turkey with dirty water, right? That you do those things on a daily basis, but you believe that because somebody is white, that they shouldn't be able to say that about you.
But why, the thing that I find fascinating about that is, why are we so shocked when they say that? If we have identified, but I'm saying, but why are we like, what? Listen, we understand what's been done. We understand the racist science that's been, developed. We understand all of these things that have compressed us into this survival class, this bottom class. We get it, right? I get it. You get it. We all get it. We all know it. And we understand who's mostly responsible. But when somebody speaks the truth to me and somebody says something to me, like that, I'm like, interesting, okay? Because I can always say to them, well, this is why. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, I do got to go out there and fix that stuff.
Right.
I do got to go out there and confront that stuff.
Right.
I had the privilege, non-privilege. I happened to be in the city of Newark this weekend. And I want everybody at home to know this one thing. And I'm not joking. I'm having a real rough day today. I got a lot of stuff to do. Newark's in trouble. Newark is literally the Wild Wild West. There's lawlessness. Oh. Just saying, it's lawlessness at a level that, I was born in a city in the 1960s.
Mm-hmm.
And I always brag about the fact that I lived in a safe neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Right?
And, it was just completely different. And I hate to harken back to those times because those are just different times. But Newark is the Wild Wild West. I mean, Eric, man, I saw some stuff, man, in this town, man, that I got to tell you, I was as brave as I think I am, as mentally tough as I think I am, I was a little twisted because they have no order. Like, how we had order. We know mm-hmm. who to do and not to do. You know the guys always set order in the neighborhood?
Mm-hmm.
Like, hey, if that guy there, you don't be around. Or that guy there, you play homage on that guy. You know how it is.
Right.
And this is little Kev. You don't touch Kev. You don't touch Kev. Go to school and shut your mouth. You know what I mean? Yo, my man. They were all over the streets. They control the streets. They control the drugs. They control the crime. I mean, these are our kids. And I said to myself, the reason why they're doing this is because they have no respect for who's leading them, and they don't have no respect for authority whatsoever. And they don't know any better, obviously. You could tell. But when I tell you South 10th Street, where he grew up at, unbelievable. I was stunned.
Well,
I'm going to tell you, I got to be honest with you. I was like, I'm talking about, and I don't like to use negative terms to describe my people, but we're in a very confused state. And they knew that there was nobody going to say anything to them. It was like business as usual. The streets were dark. They were all over the place. They were selling drugs. And then I'm driving down the street. I'm like, wait a minute, where are we?
I'm gonna try to bring up.
I gotta tell you, man. On a regular day, I wouldn't be driving through this town.
Now there's a Facebook page called Hood Press Inc.
I saw that. But do you see what I'm saying, though? So, but you see what I'm saying, though? So Cummings doesn't get a bye because Trump said something about him. that mayor that just got just getting ready to get indicted, and this new mayor, this new mayor sound like he sounded like a 2-year-old, the mm-hmm. former council president in Baltimore. Right. So just take Baltimore and Newark and just match them together. Just do it together. Remember, I always say if you take a map and you take all of the black electeds,
right,
and you take their cities
and you look at the condition they
see. You see the metrics of poverty.
But again, we saw it here, and I'm sure we're going to see it in Boston. But not in Baltimore. But we saw it here, Kevin, in the elections that took place.
Scary, man.
What'd they say? It was about stopping Trump. It wasn't about kicking out failed leadership or failed electeds and electing people who were gonna. It was about stopping Trump.
Eric, have you driven around Newark lately? Just answer the question.
I have.
Have you?
It's filthy, Kevin.
No, seriously. It is a powder keg. No, the reason I'm saying Baltimore to Newark, because I happen to live in Essex County, but Baltimore to Newark.
When I come here every day,
yeah,
I my Uber, my Lyft,
yeah,
we come through
the other side.
We come through from the North Ward, coming through Central Ward.
Oh, okay.
So we're passing Garden Spires. We're passing all of that area right over by 280.
Right.
We're coming down Bergen Street.
Right.
We're coming down. So, yeah. And then when I leave here and I go, you know, visit, which is an oasis, right, Wilbur Avenue. But on my way to Wilbur Avenue, on my way to Irvington, going up South Orange Avenue corridor, 18th Avenue, or going down Bergen Street, coming across, coming down Hawthorne Avenue, Ava Madison, all those areas, can they're horrible.
So let's just say this: we covered Trump and who he is. We said who he is, and we know who he is.
He's
and
a
you
racist.
And I never voted for him. We don't support
right.
him. All right, we got.
Right.
He is the president of he is the staffer of the Corporation of White Supremacy. Great, we got him. Right?
Right.
We got him. So now Cummings and all of these black guys that are running these cities, that are senators and congressmen, and if you look at their cities, they're in dire straits. They're in poverty.
Right.
And they have the ability to appropriate and negotiate to change that.
And they're not doing it.
They didn't do it. Their kids are killing each other. Their schools are failing.
Why don't you think they did it, Ken?
Well, they don't do it because they don't work for those people. They work for the oligarchs. See, once you get that gavel on you, see, it takes a special person. Remember Dellums from California?
Right.
Remember those great congressmen of our time? That, you know, that stood for something. You don't have those anymore. You don't have those people anymore. So if you look at what the white Congress and senators are giving their districts, I mean, real big economic projects where people are working, and you look at, you know, what we're getting with our representation in Congress and the representatives, we get nothing but the same old sad story. We're going to work with banks. We're going to help small businesses. We got to do better with our kids. We got to do better with our schools. We got to give, man, we should just bomb them. Just kick them off the island, but bomb? I can't say the word, but they got to go.
But I think some of
them
are
being kicked
off.
If anybody my age is buying that, they need to go too.
Yeah. But I think some of them are being kicked off the
island. 14th Avenue and 6th Street. Now, he's right. Let me tell you. I'm going to leave this. I know we got to go.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to tell you an Uber story. I'm not going to tell you who was in the car with me because I don't like to tell who was in the car with me. So I go to South Orange because I have to have a meeting. And so I see my buddy up in South Orange and Gray leave. I said, where are you going? He said, I'm going back to Newark. I said, come on, get an Uber with me. So I tell the Uber driver my address. So for some apparent reason, he got turned around. I mean, I'm like, what? Where's this guy going? It's a straight shot. So maybe something was happening on South Orange Avenue or whatever. So they ended up on 14th Avenue around that 6th Street. Hey, Eric, this is Wild Wild West on steroids. But it's all over now. Don't get me wrong. But wait a minute, though. All of the kids were on the porches with the white shirts, and they had music up. And they had. But guess where the cops were? Four blocks down.
Mm-hmm. Okay, listen. Have you ever experienced this?
Oh, my God.
And now you all tell me if you've experienced this. I've driven down some streets in Newark, whereas I'm going down the street, guys will get off the porch, and they've stopped the car.
Really?
Oh, they stopped the car. Where you going? I'm like, you know anybody on this block? And they're checking. Because
I'm off this radio show today. I'm done. Hurry up. I got to get out of here. Go ahead.
But I'm telling you,
I can't believe.
And what they're doing is they're checking because drive-bys happen And so they guard. So they guard the block.
Well, let me ask you a question. So now, how am I supposed to feel? Like, if Trump said something about Newark,
right?
All I can say is that Trump's a racist. But I'm not going to run up there and defend. No, no. See now, if Sharp, when let me just say something. I worked in city government. What? 14, 15
Well, wait a minute. Remember Conan O'Brien said something about Newark.
Yes, but Corey took after he said something about Newark, Corey went and got some of his money. You know, Corey, you know, he's a slave trader at a whole nother level. You know, Corey Booker's a slave trader. But what I'm saying is, are we supposed to go and defend? No, this is what they've turned Newark into. We didn't turn Newark into this.
Right.
We were a thriving Renaissance city mm-hmm. that was growing quickly. 2006 to 2019 has been done. It's over, flatline, right? So, but what I'm saying is, so if Trump said that about Newark, would he be wrong? Now, he would say, oh, he's a racist saying it. Okay, so I'm not a racist.
Right.
I'm Kevin Jenkins. I'm a native Newarker. Would I be wrong? Am I wrong? So the same thing about Baltimore. Well, and then they put the guy on TV this morning from Black Lives Matter. You know, and he tried to keep his integrity. I got to give him credit. He's like, listen, you know, we have a lot of problems in Baltimore. You know, I don't agree with the president, but we got a lot of stuff going on here.
Right.
And we should be focused on that. But they're never going to get focused on it because they don't have black men and black women that are legislators that work for them.
Right.
And then you know what we'll do? We'll find another con artist, right, to come in and say, I'm going to do a better job. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And we'll elect them. And then they'll stay on the island for another decade, too.
Right.
We keep making bad choices.
But again, so let's go back to this for a second. The reason we make these bad choices is because we don't put up people that we invest in.
No.
Right?
Yeah,
you have
true.
The oligarchs yeah. who are investing in these candidates. And then they say to us, well, here's the candidate. And then we go and vote for them. And like I always say, how are you going to cash a check at a bank that you haven't made a deposit in?
So was he wrong? Was he wrong, Eric?
No, he wasn't
okay,
wrong.
Okay, was he wrong, Eric?
Nope.
Okay.
Nope.
All right. So that's all I got to say. Was he wrong? Was he wrong about Cory Booker?
Nope.
Was Biden wrong about Cory
nope.
Booker?
Oh, and
Cory Booker left the city of Newark broke, and then this guy has finished it all.
Biden's going to lean in on Cory.
Oh, he should lean in on Cory. He should lean in on this debate. And you know what? I'm not a Biden supporter.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I have friends that are Biden supporters, right? You know, I live with a staunch Democrat. I mean, you know, we argue about Democratic Party all the time. But what I'm saying to you, what Biden should be saying about Corey, should have done a better job in Newark.
Right.
You know, you should have done a better job in Newark. That, you know, you should have got Newark straight before you attacked me. Oh, and by the way, since you want to attack me on a crime bill, I got one better for you. Why is your city arresting or stopping 85% of the black men in your town when you were mayor? Racially profiling them in their own city. You know, Michael Sproul, chickens are coming home to roost on neglected environmental conditions. Ignore your environment and you will fall victim. Yeah, that's true. You will fall victim. Okay.
There was a, and I can't find it now. There was a.
So that CNN guy, I have to go back to him. I live in Baltimore and when I went to school, nothing worse than a black man crying. Man up, we're at war. Cry after you win. You know, running on TV crying. He wanted a paycheck. He wanted to get a raise. Black men, I'm telling all you black men, listen to the show. Man up. Cry home in the bathroom. Getting on TV crying. Cummings every time, America could be better than this. You know, that's that they you know what that's really about, Eric. Emasculation of the black male. Man up. You ever see Malcolm crying?
Nope.
Martin crying?
Nope.
Mark Garvey crying?
Nope.
Huh? You ever see those guys crying?
Nope.
They might have cried when they home because they was mad and slammed the table, but they didn't get on TV crying like that. I'm just so sorry, Lord have mercy.
So I want to play this video.
Go ahead, Eric.
Right, and video. I want you guys to listen to it. I want to have a little conversation about it. Here we go.
Healing the nation and loving
yeah, video of the guy spinning wheels. He knows
It means we do have a history and we do have ghosts that we still very much battle in this country. I think about it in my own case. My maternal grandfather was the first one in our family born in the United States, born in South Carolina, and it was the Ku Klux Klan that ran him and our family out, not just of South Carolina, of this country. But it's interesting because, and the question I have for you is this. I get repeatedly asked, do you think Donald Trump is a racist? And my honest question back to them is, what does he need to say for people to stop asking me that question? What does he need to do for people to stop asking me the question of, do I think that he is a racist?
I think, first of all, he needs to stop the rhetoric, but number two, he needs to lead. And I talk about this in the book for every elected official. I'm tired of reconciliation commissions and a bunch of white people sitting around feeling good about themselves. Do something. We have inequities in school. We have inequities in housing. We have inequities in healthcare. That's what John Lewis and I talk about in this book. How do we go forward? As bad as Charlottesville was, the one benefit, it ripped the scab off. Racism is alive and well in this country. And for too long, people felt that we had dealt with the issues of racism. We haven't. And when you read this book and I talk about the history of Virginia, I mean, I took the Confederate flag through executive order off the license plate. We have 358 Confederate monuments. There are symbols to racism and hatred in this country. So we've got to get rid of the symbols. But most importantly, do something. And that's what these candidates have to talk. We can't have inferior schools. We can't. And healthcare delivery and mandatory minimum sentences, where we have an unjust racial criminal justice system. I pardoned a guy, Lenny Singleton, five robberies, a total of $550 he stole. He was a drug addict. Two life sentences plus 130 years. Are you kidding me? I could go on chapter and verse. We got to fix this. We got to bring people together. We are a great nation. We are a mosaic tile of immigrants from all over the world. Donald Trump is trying to divide us. Let's beat him.
So wait a minute. So here's the thing that I want people to hear about this. So he talked about all the things that were wrong, right? He talked about the guy who got this amazing prison sentence for almost nothing, right? He talked about having to remove the iconography, right? He talked about it still existing. But then at the end of that, he said, we're a great nation.
A mosaic.
But this is what I'm saying. How do you, from what vantage point do you believe that we are a great nation? If you just laid out a litany of things and you said racism is alive and well, but we are a great nation.
Blah, 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 blah.
So in what respect are we a great nation?
Well, listen.
What do we do that's great?
Listen.
What have we done that is great?
Listen, I've tried to be very consistent and by being here 10 to 12 every day because I believe it's the right thing to do. And, you know, I think it's time for our community. I'm just our community of folk to be more consistent. We got to get rid of these people.
We do.
You got to share the show. We have to talk about this around our dining room tables, and it's very uncomfortable. And you know, I just think that, you know, it pains me from 10 to 12 that I have to come here and have this conversation. But I don't know what else to do or say at this point. You know, when they told me to invest in my community, that's what I did. When they told me that I needed to, you know, empower young men and women in our community, that's what we did. When they said that we needed to grow out our local economy, that's what we did. When they said that we needed to create a tourism environment where people can evolve and grow and people in the arts can make money and kids can be able to have pride in their city, that's what we've got. So I don't understand, you know, what else. I'm at a standstill now, Eric. I don't know what to do at this point, because what I've seen is a reverse.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so when we had pride, now I'm even afraid to even say I live here. When I knew that we had leaders on the town, even if I didn't agree with them, but I knew they had one thing in common, that they wanted Newark to grow under their watch and evolve under their watch. We don't have that anymore. Just like Baltimore, and just like, you know, we saw Philly. And I've seen Philly grow like enormously in the last couple of years. They have some problems, but mm-hmm. it's stable. It's pushing out. Gentrification is a problem there, but they need to fix that and try to do some balanced housing. But, you know, it's like, I don't know. I don't even know what else to say anymore. What else is there to say? I think we're giving historical context. I think we're trying to break it down a lot more, unpack it a lot more, get it to where people can digest it and understand it, like kicking people off the island, you know, the managers of poverty. You know, we're codifying language. But I don't know what else to say.
Well, I'm going
to
try to play this, the clip of the...
I don't know what's, what else to
you,
say.
You know what clip I'm talking about. So we're going to try to get to that. I'm going to try to do it through, through my screen share. You tell me how it looks.
Okay, I'll do it. Let me see. Let me see how it goes through.
Yeah! Yeah, T! Yeah! Look right here. Yeah!
It's not... I don't know what's going
on. Mm-hmm. It should be coming out.
Look at Newark.
I'll tell you what I saw.
saying?
It'll come on. Mm-hmm. It'll switch over. Why didn't it go?
No,
it didn't go.
Okay. Well, we'll do it later. Tell me I'm some technical difficulty.
All right. I'm not sure why it didn't
play. Yeah, it didn't work out. We'll play. We'll find it. So anyway, so I think we covered Trump. We do this Trump thing every day. I hope people still can listen to us and share the show. But we talked about Trump. We got that out. We talked about Cummings. I think Cummings needs to be kicked off the island with a lot of his other colleagues. I think that what he should be doing in Congress is working to get money to Baltimore to fix those factories of death, which are public schools, fix their crumbling infrastructure, and make sure that, you know, that city is growing and evolving so families can grow economically and deal with the real issues. No, stop talking about black people in colored terms. Black Americans are the ones that are suffering.
Right.
So say black people. I don't understand this people of color. It makes me sick to my stomach. Black people are suffering in Baltimore. Black people are suffering in Philadelphia. Black people are suffering in North New Jersey. You know, just be smart. Yeah. Stop taking all these code words to make everybody else feel better. Black people. So, you know, when I hear people say, oh, the people of color. Uh-huh. No, that's not true. And I know it's uncomfortable. Right. That's why we got to know that we have to have our own club. People don't like the fact that I'm telling black Americans, foundational black Americans, you have to have your own club and you have to be selective. And just because you got some black skin, that doesn't make you a part of that club because, you know, from 1619, we were a club of people that were what? Tortured, murdered. Right. Yeah, we're a club. So you got to accept that. We got to stop letting everybody in the club. Mm-hmm. I don't let anybody in the club. What I tell you, Eric, I don't know that person. Let that person sit over there. You can't come over here and talk to me. Because you know what they do? And this is the shameful part about it. When I was growing up and I traveled, when I went to Jamaica, you know what they would say? And these are beautiful people. I'm Jamaican.
Mm-hmm.
When I go to I'm Haiti, Haitian.
Right.
When I go to Ghana, I'm Ghanaian. When I go to Brazil, I'm Brazil. I'm part of this tribe, blah, 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 blah. National pride. National pride. So when they come here and they say, look, I'm like, well, what club, what tribe are you from? I'm from Brazil. Okay, cool. Boom, 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 boom. Now, that doesn't mean they celebrate what I'm trying to get through. I'm working with me to get through what I'm getting through. They come here and they cloak themselves and they cape themselves and their blackness, right? But they're all working towards getting what? Accepted by those group of people that are killing us. I don't understand how as intelligent as my people are, I can't understand why they're so uncomfortable with that conversation. It's real. It's in your face every day. So they come in, you're a bottom cast, and they come in and this is what they say. I don't understand why those Kafas, those Kifla, whatever they say in so many different languages, can't get their act together. They can't. Don't you marry none of them. They're not worthy. Now, we all know that to be true.
Right.
But then when they want to create some universal discussion about blackness, we all got to be included. No, I'm a part of a special club. No. With all the bad stuff, I'm a part of a special club.
Yeah.
And I can't understand why black Americans don't get it. Right. They drive me crazy when they do that. And that's all I'm saying to you. I'm not saying that these are not nice people. I'm not saying that some of them might not get it. But I'm a part of a unique club. You know, and I get that. And when all of these people come in and they cloak themselves and then I see black Americans out there caping for them and, you know, yeah, but you don't even know who these people are. And that's the black dilemma. So Cummings is a problem for us. Booker is a problem for us. M5 is a problem for us. The economic indicators, social indicators, the confidence indicators, they're all running flat. They're red. They're in the red. We're not in the black. So as a business person or a person with any common sense, you got to know that this ain't working for you. So you're going to get up every morning. It's like a woman get up every morning, woman get up every morning, a man whooping on her every day, and she going to think that by next week is going to get better. He's just having a rough time at the job.
Yeah.
Oh, it's white supremacy that's stopping him from doing it. So come on, folks.
We got to get on top of it.
Come on, man. It's crazy.
We got to get on top of it.
What club are you on? I'm asking everybody now. What club are you?
So
I bet you they won't sit in. They won't be in an oppressed people club. I tell you that.
Hey, Kevin.
Yes, sir.
Where'd you get this water from?
Oh, this is filtered water.
Is it filtered water?
pH balance.
I have pH balance. Bottle.
Yeah, I've spent about $3,000 in the last couple of, maybe a year. Maybe a year and a, look, I mean, you notice I can't.
We're going to put the bottle over here.
Because, you'd be in trouble now. That's you started trouble now.
Right.
I don't know if the camera picks it up.
No, it got it. See, that's the... because we can't drink Nork water.
Yeah, we can't drink Nork water.
So in Business Insider.
Yeah.
In Business Insider.
That was good.
A water crisis outside New York City has surpassed Flint, according to a pediatrician who helped uncover the Flint disaster.
Yeah. I read that, I guess this morning or yesterday evening, it was sent to me. I think you got it too. You know, a water crisis outside of New York City has surpassed Flint, according to a pediatrician who helped uncover the Flint disaster. So what you're saying is this. Someone came into Newark who discovered the Flint crisis and told Newarkers in the Ironbound that you have even a worse crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yep.
And basically you're dying.
Yeah.
Basically, your kids are in jeopardy. Basically, everything you do in your life needs water, and your water is poison.
Right.
And then this administration, right,
mm-hmm.
tells you that that woman is lying. A pediatrician, the one that discovered the crisis in Flint, the one that said our Newark is worse than Flint, they say she's lying. And then they put out a slick commercial saying that, because I got to tell you, it's really you're talking about maximum sophisticated confusion. They put out a slick commercial and they're saying Newark is on a Newark is on a move. But by the way, you're dying.
It's
poison. Yeah. So listen to what I'm saying. This is maximum sophisticated confusion at another level. But wait a minute though. But they did it. It's so disrespectful, right? That I gotta laugh because it for people that I don't live in Essex County.
Mm-hmm.
You live in Bloomfield.
I live in Bloomfield.
So I live in Essex County. I ain't telling nobody I live in a place with dirty water. But it should be offensive. The lady comes in from the look. We six times, seven times, maybe eight times. They said our water is worse than Flint.
Right.
And that there's no good levels of lead. And again, then I hear that they're making a guy that has no experience, that they're going to literally make this guy the director of the water department. That is a crime. So wait a minute. So read a little bit of the article. Pull it back up.
Well, so it says children exposed to lead can suffer permanent brain damage.
That's funny.
Which often results in learning disabilities and increased violent behavior. In adults, chronic exposure to low levels of lead can cause nausea, seizures, and reproductive issues.
So check this out. It says seizures, right? So we have seniors, we have people that have seizures, we have people that are like, you know, that's a brain thing, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Just explained it right. Then reproductive issues. We have a lot of people in this town that are pregnant, newly pregnant, right?
Yep.
You have children that are in their younger years, and it says learning disabilities.
Mm-hmm.
So not only are we sending them into burning factories of death, now we're sending them into factories of death with the potential of having those problems.
Right. And then
that's pretty deep.
Further, it says, now this is not me or you, Kev, right? This isn't...
This is the business insider.
This isn't me or you, right? This is Business Insider. Says, when I walk the streets of Newark, I feel like I am walking in Flint, said Hannah Atisha, the pediatrician.
Mm.
Here's a city that has suffered from disinvestment, unemployment, population loss, decades of neglect, violence, crime, and mass incarceration.
Wow.
All these other issues that make it toxic for children to grow up.
Read that again. Just read that one more time.
Yo, I mean,
can
I
read it?
Yo,
can I read it?
Go
when I walk the streets of Newark, I feel like I'm walking in Flint. So, okay, said Hannah Atisha. Here's a city that has suffered from disinvestment. We talk about this on the show all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Underemployment. She says unemployment. Underemployment. Population loss. Where is it? Did it go off?
No, it's
is
coming
it,
back. Decades population, of?
Decades of neglect, violence, crime, and mass incarceration. All these other issues that make it toxic for children to grow. So all of these social ills.
We didn't make that. Wait, so this woman who's not from
New York
came and she went on 14th.
She went on 14th Street.
She took the wrong turn.
She went on 10th.
Okay.
And she didn't walk this neighborhood.
And she's not taking a blue pill.
No, no. That's an indictment. But it says at the end here, issues that make it toxic for children to grow up. Now, issues that make it toxic. Now, put the poison water on top of that. We're done.
Right. And so further, the article says.
And you know what their job is?
What?
To try to fool us, to lie to us, to mock. Some fool is in their offices telling them, well, we got to put a spin on your life. Some fool, he's paying, a fool's paying a fool to put a spin on your life. Now, that's what Trump does.
Right.
That's what Facebook did, right?
Right.
That's what Facebook did during the Russian the 2016 right? No, fake propaganda to fool you, to make you feel a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what they did. And I mean,
here's the other part.
It's fascinating.
Since January 2017, Newark's water has been tested 5 times by the state. With each result, the lead levels have exceeded 15 parts per billion. The threshold used by the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, to require public water systems to take action to reduce lead contamination. So, 5 times. 5 times it has tested above that. And they continue to lie. And they continue to lie. We've had Brenda Toiloy on. Where she
Thomas calls in, Diaz,
all of these people
Donna have been walking and talking for the longest about this. I mean, I remember when Gail said the water was poison, he said it was a political ploy. I mean, the guy is amazing. No, well, you know, I blame us for that. You know, I blame us. And guess what? The state's culpable.
Right.
I think personally what the city of Newark should do is citizens should step out of the NRDC suit, let that happen,
mm-hmm.
but sue them personally for damages. Literally, sue the state and sue the city personally, individuals, for damages. Because they know it's a lie. And then to really promote that the things that they're doing to fix it is, you know, the piping, the sewage lines or fix the mm-hmm. pipes, that's a lie too.
So here's another headline in it. It says, not all households have received water filters. So now, they talked about the fact that they had passed out some 38,000 water filters, but we had Anthony Diaz call in and say that a lot of people were being turned away, right? That they hadn't received the water filters, that people would go and then they would tell them that their name wasn't on the list or their house wasn't on the list and that they didn't have lead in their water, and so they've been turned away. So it says not all households have received water filters, a critical tool for keeping them safe. In May, Newark Mayor Ross Baraka, we said we were going to say his name.
M5,
told local residents that the city was working aggressively to distribute water filters and pay to replace lead service lines. Newark is not Flint, he said. The city of Newark did not immediately respond to Business Insider's request for comment.
He said, Newark wasn't Brooklyn. And mm-hmm. he's absolutely right.
Right.
I think Brooklyn has like 2 million, 3 million people in it. Has one of the most thriving local economies in the country. I mean, to compare or to suggest that he doesn't want Newark to be Brooklyn does us a disservice. Right? There are some things that Brooklyn should be doing better. Mm-hmm. But overall, it's one of the greatest local economies in the world. Right? And people are thriving and working. And there's some social issues that they need to resolve. But to say that you don't want Newark to be Brooklyn, which says that you want Newark to be trapped in poverty. You don't want to entice new industry. You don't want to build confidence. You don't want to do anything. And then he has this girl walking around somebody named Glover. I keep forgetting her name. She actually believes she knows what she's doing. She's peacocking around the city of Newark like she knows what she's doing. I'm like, this woman has no idea what she's doing.
Right.
How to jumpstart a local economy. You know what their business is now? Giving conferences. They just give conferences now. That's all they do is give conferences.
So the last part of this, it says, because the city hasn't declared a state of emergency, Hannah Atisha said, some residents haven't grasped the scope of the problem. Everybody I talk to, I'm like, have you heard about Newark? Do you know what's going on? She said, this is what keeps me up at night. So here's the deal, right? Now let's understand, when NRDC first came on the scene, they wanted to know what Newark was doing to notify residents. And M5 was lying.
No, he didn't even talk to him.
He told him that the water was running. No. He told him, Kevin, before all of this stuff happened, when they closed down all of the water fountains in the city, in the schools, and residents and activists asked him directly, does this have to do with the infrastructure of Newark? Does it have to do with households? And they said specifically to him, these pipes run into homes too. And his response was, no, this is isolated to the schools.
That's malfeasance.
He said that.
That's malfeasance. But let me just tell you why we can't get attracted to Disneyland. There's a lot of new development that happened under Gail's watch, and we talk about it all the time. We see these beautiful apartments, you know, downtown. Guess what? Half of them within a year's time is going to be empty. And half of them are predominantly empty now.
Right.
And, you know, it gives the people the impression that, you know, something great is happening. There's nothing great happening. It pains me to say that. There's nothing great happening whatsoever. No one has confidence in the government. No one has confidence in this market. That there's no confidence. And then the corporate community isn't, they're in a pickle. Because what they're doing is they're trying to give the illusion that something great is happening here. But over their morning coffee, they're like, this is some crazy stuff that's happening here. You know what I mean? Like, and then they got to subsidize people to live here. They have to give you money. They have to say, please come and stay. We'll give you some money to stay. So you'll stay for a couple of years and you bank that money. And then you go put your 30% on the house someplace that's got good schools, got good educated community, got people that are not, you know, that want to have a thriving, you know, neighborhood, that kind of thing. So we got this guy bouncing around in a black car where they're all sitting up there and their towers doing like this, scratching their head saying, when are we going to get back to normal? When are we going to get back to trying to grow out this city? When are we going to get back to try to grow out this local economy? When are we going to get some competent people in here that understand that they need to administrate and partner with us to change this, not to have an opportunity zone conference to nowhere, not to have the state, I got to read what I wrote, but the state, I think I did the other day, but the state's coming here to do a conference for small business and LGBT
that
veteran. I mean, just three card Monty.
Right.
Has nothing to do with the issue. It won't eradicate anything, and you'll just have a bunch of people that get a free day to walk into NJIT, because NJIT now is the new conference center for Newark.
But Kevin, you know,
it's a disgrace.
But he understands
it's that, absolutely a disgrace.
But he understands things are not going to get
better. This is the problem. I'm going to say this, and I want to say this. He doesn't understand anything.
No.
Listen, let me just be clear. I'm going to take a leap here. I'll take the word he understands. See, I'm of the opinion that not only does he not care, but I believe he has a social disorder. And when people have social disorders, their brain is fragmented because they're so narcissistic that it doesn't matter if he cared or not. His brain and his concept of himself won't allow him to understand and be honest about the fact he doesn't know what the hell he's doing. So there's some mental stuff going on there. And I like to break it down like that because I don't want anybody to just say he just made a decision, say he doesn't care. No, I think there's a real disorder there, because you have to understand, for somebody that has been marching and screaming and hollering and he finally gets elected and God helps, I mean, God bless him, he gets to become mayor and he does this, that means all along he was mentally frailed and we didn't just see it. I saw it, but some people didn't see it. So there's a mental disorder there. I'm not going to put him in normal space that he's just making a calculated decision. Just like we say Trump's crazy.
Right.
We need to test this, do a piss test on him. Mm-hmm. We need to do a piss test on this guy. Because there's no way. Look, if my mother lives on South 10th Street.
Right.
Right? I'm going to ask you a question. Now, I'm being serious.
Sure.
If my mother lived on South 10th Street,
mm-hmm.
that would be the best block in the city.
Absolutely.
Well, if I lived,
let's look at it, right? When Ken Gibson was mayor,
oh, you got to be kidding.
Tuxedo Park, it was the place to be.
When I lived in the North Ward, mm-hmm. all those years, you could not. But those people are wonderful. They're wonderful people. But there's nothing that was going to go on in that neighborhood. You sit in front of my house. Let me ask you a question, Eric. Does anybody sit in front of my house?
Nope.
Do they sit to even take a break to walk nope. home? But now this guy, he drives all around this city in the wait a minute. I gotta go. I'm gonna leave out of here. I gotta go. Because I can't take your show anymore. I love you, but I'm done. He brings a guy, the Bernie Madoff of development, this black guy. Oh my God, I forgot his name. And he goes up on I forgot the guy's name. But he goes up on Springfield Avenue, and he brings the City Hall symbol, and they do a street class about how to buy property and how to buy back the block. I swear to God. Last week, and he was standing up there with the mic in the dirty field that was dirty all this time. They must have just cleaned it up. And the guy took an easel out and started, I forgot the guy's name. He's the Bernie Madoff of development. He goes all around the country. We're going to buy the block. He's got 450,000 views. And he's a complete lunatic. But this guy, M5, was standing with him, wow. giving him credibility. And he had the easel. Look, and he was doing a street thing about how you got to both buy back the block. We got to buy back the block.
But Kev.
Man, I'm out of here, man.
But here's the thing. Here's the question I'm going to ask
Jesus Christ.
With all of this, and this is why I say it's maximum sophisticated confusion. And I'm putting it up now. The headline is NORC considers giving guaranteed income to all city residents. So, wait a minute. So, if we're talking about buying back the block, right? If we're talking about, NORC going forward, that things are hopping and popping in NORC, that unemployment is down and, folks are working and businesses are thriving and there's a thriving nightlife and all these things. Why are we talking about giving NORC residents a guaranteed income?
Listen, you know what, man? I have no idea what the hell is going on. I don't even know. I keep trying to tell you. I'm going to tell you what happens in the daily, and I believe that happens in his administration. He's sitting up in that dark room, and somebody comes up, with some crazy social idea. I'm not even calling it socialism, but a social idea.
Mm-hmm.
And he believes that if he does this, this will get the poor people of NORC to like him. I mean, really, it's just that small. Oh, if I do this, you ever notice when he did the 2020 thing?
Right.
He did a press conference. When he did the, gentrification, we're going to put a committee to fight gentrification. Sure. People just stopped building. When he passed the legislation that him and Gail were fighting back and Gail told him it was going to slow up development, he had to get it done. So now he's got some social scientists that popped in from into NORC, say this is a poor city. They don't have to seem to have a strong government.
Mm-hmm.
They seem to be third world country, right? You know what? We're gonna experiment. Let's go talk to this mayor and make him feel like he's going to do something great for his people. Now, this didn't work in Finland. This didn't work in a lot of places. But what I'm going to do is this, Eric. I'm going to do one better. I'm just trying to get my page up if I can. I don't know why I'm having a time of doing that today, but I'm going to try to get this up.
For which article?
The article from Finland first.
Okay.
I think I put it on my page. I don't know why I'm doing this. Oh, okay. Here, I think I got it.
You got it?
Yeah, I think I do. I'm sorry.
No. I think you sent it to me.
So yeah, I think I sent it to you, buddy.
Here, do you want to read it from my phone?
Yeah, let me read it from your phone. I don't know why. Thank you.
Yep.
It says, Hilki Halamo, professor of social policy at the University of Helsinki, comments on the preliminary results of Finland's basic income experiment. Effects on the labor market were minimal. Like labor market. Was like this. Minimal. And survey results demonstrating that basic income receipts had had better subjective well-being can be questioned. The basic income experiment in Finland has gained unprecedented attention around the world. However, the preliminary results of the experiment are disappointing. The labor market effects, which were the focus of the experiment, seem negligible. Survey results demonstrated that basic income recipients have better subjective well-being. However, these results can be called into question. The concept of basic income gathered interest from legislators and governments in the United States and Canada in the 1970s, resulting in local experiments. But the experiment in Finland was the first nationwide randomized field experiment on the idea. Now, listen to what I'm saying to you. Experiment.
Mm-hmm.
When they want to experiment on education, they come to Newark. We're the place where they experiment all the bad stuff, all of the bad social ideas. Now, this experiment is in Newark. So they're saying we're going to give these people money for a year, and let's see how that has an income, how that has an impact on the labor force, right? So it says here, from the 1970s onward, social policies on both sides of the Atlantic have been dominated by workfare, where payments of benefits is made conditional on participation on job-promoting activities such as training, we do that poorly here, rehabilitation, we do that poorly here, and work experience, we do that poorly here, or an unpaid or low-paid worker. Come on, man. I'm done. Hey, take this phone from me, man. I'm done. What am I supposed to say? He's allowing some foundation or some think tank to come in here and experiment to dare suggest if we give universal income, that's going to have a positive impact on our workforce, on our labor workforce. And by the way, it's going to stimulate, you know, our economy because they're going to have money to spend. Oh, and by the way, the training and all of the other things that come along with it will be enhanced. That's maximum sophisticated confusion. That is at the height of, like, stupidity.
Well, listen, I'm getting ready to, I'm trying to find a video, and hopefully you guys can enjoy it.
This is crazy.
Right? I'm going to play this video. Maybe
things like that in the 21st century.
So here we go.
Ontario, speaking of socialism and it not working, in Ontario, they announced last year, maybe you remember, that they're going to do a 3-year program where they send money to people. The minimum income thing. So they selected 4,000 people who I guess were at or below the poverty line. Some had jobs, some didn't have jobs. And then they just sent them money. If you're a single person, you could get $17,000. If you were a married couple, I think it was $24,000. And you could get $6,000 more than that if you're somewhat disabled. So you could get up to $30,000 in minimum income every year. And we're going to do that for 3 years. They just shut down the program after 1 year. Why? It's unsustainable. We can't do it. It doesn't work. First of all, it didn't help the economy. Secondly, it is bringing down the government because they can't afford it. Hello? Of course you can't afford it. And that was only 4,000 people. For a year, imagine if we just do some kind of nationwide program, because everybody's saying, oh, it's time for a minimum income. We've got to do something. A lot of jobs are going to be lost. We've got to have a minimum income. No, it doesn't work. It's unsustainable. And the people now that you're sending $24,000 to are all pissed off. They're going ape crap. How dare you take this? I need this money. Yep. Well, okay. Well, yep. You've created dependency. Again, it doesn't work in any way.
Oh.
There's so many bad things about it that it's difficult to even describe them in one show.
Ways, Eric, to deal with this pending crisis that are in front of us. And you know what it is? It's to get rid of these people that are wholesaling this garbage.
Right.
This is a serious job to look at poverty, measure it correctly, look at your workforce, look at your untrained workforce, look at how your local economy can grow and not grow, look at what kind of industries you're bringing to the city, bringing real people around the table to have a real serious conversation. There is not one person that works for this present administration that knows what the hell they're talking about. And when those people go in the room to talk to people like us, we laugh at them. Right. We look at them like this. Well, that's where you want to start? You want to do a conference? That's where you want to start? You want to do a press conference? That's what you want to start? They laugh at them.
Take a picture. It is a big joke.
Right. You have these people prancing around this town that have no experience on the complexities of how to grow out a local economy, how to look at a city as an emerging market, how to look at development and triangulate that, right, into sort of confidence in the marketplace. You don't have it. Right. So what I'm saying to you is, why am I talking to you? I'm tired of talking to you, Eric.
Right.
This is what I'm saying. Who the hell puts this out in the market where you know that's not the remedy for it?
The thing is,
it's insulting.
And I've said this forever.
Jesus.
None of them. Whether you're talking about the guy in Irvington, the guy in Orange, the guy in East Orange, the guy in Newark, right? The folks in Baltimore, wherever you go, they don't understand what an urban economic development plan is.
But you know what though? You're absolutely right. But here's the deal. Right. Well, let's do this. Let's just say this. Let's just give, because you and I are very fair people.
Mm-hmm.
I think we really are. I don't have a heart. You have a better heart than me. If we went to Irvington and we went to East Orange and we said, listen, here's the deal. Now, I put my bona fides up. I don't want to work for you anymore. Here's what it takes to get that done. Right? I'm going to ask my friend to get me in front of them. Because I know people that know them really well. And I'm going to say, okay, here's where your economy is. Here's where your growth is. Here's what your corridors, your local corridors are bringing you. Here's what your tax, and this is it. This is what you have to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to talk no political hacks. I don't want no fake BAs in the room. I don't want no, because none of them are real BAs. None of those guys know what they're doing.
Right.
But I would love to ask that question of both of those men. Because see, when I go to their streets, and this is interesting, their streets are clean. You know, I don't see anybody marching up. I don't know about those towns, you always tell you. But I'm interested to see if they understand what we're saying to them. Like, here's what, you know, your local economy looks like. This is what it could look in the future. Here's what your development footprint looks like. This is basic formula, right? But, you know, you could tinker with it. But look at Newark. Look at Jersey City. This is a prime example. People always talk about Jersey City is growing and it is.
It depends on where.
But it is.
Yeah.
And guess what? The F word, they're going to be wiped out.
Right.
Because those black elected leaders over there didn't make themselves a part of this grand plan.
Right.
They kept them over there in the corner. Well, I got to keep these black people over here. They are poor, but I represent them. So when the big game and the big discussion was happening, those people were not a part of
right.
it. You know, so that's what I'm saying to you. So when you look at Newark, you know,
but
I was going to be pretty cool with you today. I was going to be calm with you today.
And folks need to understand this. I could go and bring some pretty heavy hitters in who could talk about what kinds of things need to be done. You don't have people in City Hall who could execute.
What? Oh, my God.
You don't have people in City Hall who could execute. So you got $140,000 salary here, $120,000 salary here, $160,000 salary here. And that's all they have, a salary.
It's embarrassing.
But if you took them to plan, you could go and I could go and find some folks who could do an audit, right? Evaluate, provide them with a plan.
Listen.
They couldn't execute.
They got one plan. It's one plan. There's one plan in place. These people in this town, you're done. You're done. This is the plan. You're done.
And so what you're looking at is this.
Because you're not, once you lose momentum, listen, what I tell you all the time, once you lose momentum, it's hard to get it back.
Right.
It's very difficult to get that momentum back. So Newark has had three tries. So from 1995 to 2006, enormous growth, enormous confidence. An administration that knew how to administer, an administration that was working on all cylinders, a council that was productive and protective value and appropriated the right way, right? $1 billion investment, reduced your taxes, cleaned your streets, had competent directors, had a focus for the city. We get Corey in, we came to Brick City. The hell is a Brick City? Then you know what he did? He nationalized him and criminalized us and demeaned us right. and put us in a box. Then we got this other guy, the Trojan horse, right? Now he's going to wipe us off. Now the horse the horse that we kept thinking Corey was, he's that Trojan horse.
Absolutely.
Okay? So that's what I'm trying to say to you. I mean, it's sickening. I get sick and tired of talking about this, but I want the informed class to know I'm sick and tired of them not doing, not them person, not them, but we got to say enough of you, as my grandmother would say.
Yeah.
I mean, are you kidding me? So now you got a conference, another conference. You got the colleges are doing a smart thing. They want a conference again. They're not doing any work scientifically on how to create a better environment for our city. Come on, man. What they really want to do is get our properties for free
right.
and not pay any taxes.
Right. So nobody shows up at these things. You know, nobody shows up at these conferences, Kevin. The residents don't show up.
Well, see, here's the deal. Residents probably don't show up for a number of reasons, and I get that, but not all residents are the same. I'm figuring that out too. So I got friends like you, and we talk, and you know, we trying to live mm-hmm. and do what we got to do, right? I don't need about 450. I just want people to know, even if you don't do anything at this point for me, do you know what's really going on? Are you aware of really what's going on? That's just start right. there. Like, I don't even want you to do anything. Don't get up and walk down the street, but are you aware of this con job, right? And this is what I said and I wrote it this weekend because I got one of those moments, Eric, when I get up and I see something so stupid that I have to respond to it. And it was about, you know, the universal peace. And it was real clear. I tried to be real simple about it. Sorry, Eric.
Somebody said they were watching the budget hearing, and it was, when was the budget hearing?
I don't know. He probably played that cartoon that he had. What did they say about it?
Just said that it was horrible.
Yeah, it was horrible. So this is what I said. I said, this is my commentary called The Trojan Horse. I said, this guy has truly become a distraction. While Newark is dying and moving forward, to coin his phrase, to its pending death, he is now allowing some social scientists to experiment on the poor and frustrated people of Newark. These poverty experiments have not worked anywhere in the world. So they, of course, had to find a city like Newark, a third world city, because I'm going to go back to that later, third world city, just as Senator Cory Booker, who promotes Newark while running for president, as a distraught city with poisoned water and failing public schools. A city with one of the highest underemployment rates in the country, a city where safety has left the building. Damn, while I'm writing this, I can just imagine what the business community must be thinking and not saying over their morning coffee. What the hell? When will we ever get back to normal, where confidence rules and investment thrives, where people want to live, and we corporate Newark don't have to subsidize them to stay? This local economy has flatlined, and this guy and his administration live in a delusional state that even frightens his cult members. I'm really concerned about Newark. Over the last several years, we've seen this guy out-Trump even Trump. It seems to me that he has no idea what he's doing, but it also seems to me that Newarkers have also given up. But Newarkers, I can assure you all the things your mother and father used to tell you around the dining room table about outsiders coming to take over Newark was wrong. Their prophecy missed the mark. What they should have told us was a native son will destroy it first, and then they will come and eat the spoils. Well, Newark, all that Greek mythology I read on Mercer Street was good for something. I saw the Trojan horse from day one. God help us. Now, I'm a native Newarker. Remember your dining room table?
Mm-hmm.
What did your mother and father used to say? They used to say, they're going to come and take over Newark.
Right.
They're going to do this. Remember, all them, I look at my mother like, why are they always talking about this?
Yeah.
I used to look at my parents like, who's going to come over and take? And then as I got older and got more involved in the business I was in, I started to see some of that, but I still didn't understand it because I wanted to grow up in a city that was diverse. I wanted to grow up in a city that was thriving. I wanted to grow up in a city where people weren't afraid to open up small businesses and live in their neighborhoods. I wanted that.
Well, so here, you know, the city has a Facebook page, which they blocked me from, by the way.
But it's
their official page. I don't think that it's legal for them to do that,
no,
but they
not.
Did it. Right?
They
anyway,
blocked you?
Yeah.
Damn.
So I get on through another account.
Okay, no problem.
Anyway, they post the article about it. I just want to read a couple of comments. So this one person, John Anthony, says, fix the schools, fix the streets, get rid of all the drug dealers and fake and real gang members downtown Newark day and night. Bring more legitimate companies that will hire folks in Newark like Walmart. I don't know about that. Yeah. Bring better food options. Clean up all of downtown Newark. Do that, please. Then you have another person says, that is an absolutely horrible idea. Here's another one, Warren Dixon. Yeah, right. Free medical, dental, and prescriptions is what is really needed. This article really doesn't tell me much about what is actually being proposed or where the money is coming from. We definitely need more details before writing a story like this, because they just pitched the story out as you know, propaganda, right? Where's the money coming from to finance this idea? Somebody else says, we can't even take care of the homeless population.
Wow.
How are we going to, you know, do this? They haven't figured, you know, the homeless population thing out. Here's another one. How about giving DPW workers a fair raise and a fair contract first? Put the money into training people, finding them jobs, etc. Ridiculous proposal. So there's nobody in here. I'm not skipping anything. There's nobody in here that's saying that they think this is a great idea. Put that money towards cleaning up the city. It's so easy to spend other people's money, isn't it? I mean, I could continue to go on. Laughable. Somebody says this is a joke.
That's not you saying it.
No.
And that's not me saying.
No. And literally, Kevin, I didn't cherry pick. I went straight down.
But you have to understand, he doesn't care because he has a social disorder. It's about what he thinks is important in his small world. Like what will make him look good to the poverty class, the people that are trapped in poverty. That's what this is all about. So it's not, you know, you're talking about hubris at another level. Hubris at another level.
Mm.
No homeless strategy, no job creation strategy. No, nothing. Just flatline. This economy is flatline. And I mean, the people that live in this town that are taxpayers and renters, they're held hostage. You know, and this guy, and I wish somebody would. I mean, I swear to you, man. I'm so old now, Eric. I wish I would have a joker come and say, if they say that I'm wrong about something, right, about this local economy, about the incompetence of this administration, the lack of effectiveness of this administration, what it takes to grow out a local economy, how to attract new industry in a very balanced and creative way. I wish one person, one human being in this thread says anything to me about that. And you got to know that is the enemy. Now, you want to talk about that? You want to talk about international trade and tourism? You want to talk about the effectiveness of the port and our airport and how we're supposed to be measuring that for a return for the city? Man, you better stay offline. I'm getting old now. You got to have these conversations. See, if I was having a conversation with a corporate community about this, my language would be different, right? Obviously. My pitch would be different, obviously. I would be talking about historically what has happened and where we're going. Those discussions would be different.
Right.
But I'm having a discussion with some real people in real time, sure, that I need to explain this in a very, very interesting way. I can't speak development speak and expect people to understand all of the aspects of it.
Right.
But there's no confidence in this marketplace.
No, there's not.
There's confusion in this marketplace. And when you say buy back the block, I mean, what are you talking about? Do you know what the racial income racial income gap in this city is?
Right.
What are you talking about? You're going to create an LLC. What are you talking about?
But that's what I'm saying. So on one hand,
man,
there's a conversation about buying back the block. But on the other hand, it's about giving them money. So I'm going to give you free money so that you can go and buy back the block.
Maximum sophisticated confusion. Anybody that's coming in this town.
But I want you to understand what I just said to you, Kev. we want you to buy back the block with the free money that we're going to give you through the universal basic.
Well, thing. First of all, I know you understand
what I'm saying, right? Because we know you don't have any money. That's why we want to try to piece this
out. All right, so first of all, let's just deal with this issue on hand. Number one issue for black businesses in any part of this country is access to capital. Access to capital. I'm not talking about some unique small fund that you're saying invest in and then we will do. Now, I'm talking about access to capital.
Right.
Period. Stick a pin in it. Let's start that conversation first before you come in here with all that bull crap. Access to capital. Oh, okay, so here's the next thing. Well, we're going to create a fund.
It's laughable, Kevin.
We're going to create a fund, and it's going to be an urban development fund. Come on, man. Been there, done that, man. Listen, I'm 56 years old, man. I've seen every aspect of development on the planet Earth. So, and if you got to create a fund like that, you got to understand how that's done. So you're saying you're going to create an urban development fund, and you're going to buy distressed properties.
Wait, was this the land bank thing you said?
The land bank.
Urban development fund, a land bank.
Who's investing in the fund?
Right. Urban development fund, a land bank, universal basic income.
Listen.
I mean, what?
Listen.
A sanctuary city.
I was in South Beach. There's so much stuff. Let me just tell you this, though. I was in South Beach several hundred years ago. And the young man had just opened up his hotel. He's a major player in the development. He mm-hmm. actually started a phenomenal fund. His name just escapes me. Gail and I had dinner with him. I know his family. He's over in New York doing a bunch of stuff. I just can't remember these names, but I was going to reach out for him because we kept in contact over the years, right? And, you know, he just started a fund because he was actually saying, listen, let's stop the bull crap. You know, when we talk about developers getting in the game, we talk about black women wanting to get into the development game. He's starting a fund with about 500, you know, he's raising the money, 500, 600 million,
mm-hmm.
right? And he understands that at the end of the day, if they don't get real access, they can't play. Right. They'll take the fees, but they can't really play long term,
mm-hmm.
right? So he understands there's a market, there's a possibility that he can do this, but he has to, his name escapes me. I got to come back with his name. It'll come back in my head. But I met him when he first built his hotel and on Collins, right? And it was first of his kind. His brother, he's a phenomenal young man. I just can't remember his name. And so I remember having this conversation with him and his wife. We were young. Gail and I were young then. And Gail, we brought everybody to his hotel. We went to the Black Film Festival. A young guy from Newark who we love started the Black Film Festival. So we took everybody to the Black Film Festival, but we made everybody stay in his hotel.
Mm-hmm.
Stay in his hotel for every time we went, we made him stay in his hotel, right? So we had this conversation. I said, well, where did you get your money from? And we started laughing. He said, well, I patched it together, some family money, some people that invite, but he had a major investor drive his business for him, right? Mm-hmm. And now he's independent. But his number one issue was access to capital. Number one.
Right.
So when people are saying, oh, we can do this, where are you going to get the capital from? Where are you going to get it from? Come on, man. I mean, they're out there in the field talking about buy your block back, laying out some Ponzi scheme, talking about.
I got to
show that to you.
Show it to me. Yeah. We'll put it up.
Now, when I tell you about Miami, when I tell you about Chicago, when I tell you about these cities, you know why I can tell you about those cities, Eric? Because I've been there. Understand some of the troubles that they're having. Understanding why black developers aren't really in the game. Understanding why they don't have capacity. Understanding why they can't see themselves through long term. Come on, man. I'm just so sick of it. And then they come in Newark talking about an LLC. Okay, just take Newark for instance, right?
Mm-hmm.
So take their Newark Housing Authority, right? Take their Board of Education,
right?
Take their administration, right? How many black businesses and black developers are doing business? I'm not talking about fronts. I'm not talking about fronting for somebody. How many black developers you think are doing business in the city of New York right now?
Wait a minute. You know what? So the mayor has, I know you're going to kill me for this, but the mayor has his men's meeting where he's telling these people how to become business owners.
I ain't even been spending that much time on that.
Entrepreneurs. And I'm assuming
he's never been an entrepreneur.
But I'm assuming, Kevin,
he's never been. How can a person that's never been an entrepreneur tell you how to be an entrepreneur?
Kev, I'm assuming.
Come on.
That some of them have gotten something of value out of those meetings that they attend, and that maybe they're doing business.
Well, they did get something good out of it. They got emotionally bamboozled. They did. They did get something out of it. Go ahead, y'all. Go out there and open up these LLCs if you want to. You go ahead and see what happens to you. Nothing. I mean, come on. I mean, I didn't even want to spend that much time with him today, but I think the Cummings thing got me interested because you can see that pattern all across this country.
Of course.
And you can hear those lies constantly being told to a constituent selling them garbage as hope. And, you know, and you don't need, you know, any of these guys, man.
But there's nothing else to sell them.
Yeah, you know what? That's right.
Think about it, Kevin. That's right. You got nothing else to sell them.
Well, I'm not going to sell you the Brooklyn Bridge. Look, what I always tell you, Eric, don't come and sell me Brooklyn Bridge twice. I bought it twice. So my issue is universal income's a distraction. You know, not telling the truth about your local economy and where your city is going is a problem.
Right.
And the people that are poor and trapped in poverty that don't have a way out, and it's just going to get worse. It's just going to get worse. You have a government that does not. We don't have a government.
We don't.
But you have a group of people that are continuing to sell you garbage as hope and manage poverty. And that's it.
And that's it.
Anybody that says that anything tells you different anything than that.
That tells you life is going to get better right now.
Because how can it? I gave you three examples.
You have to get rid of the people who are here.
But I gave you three examples.
Right.
A strong administration, strong local economy, a clear direction of where the city was going. Right?
Right.
Up until Cory Booker. Cory Booker to M5. It's over. You're done. Everything that's being built now that you see was on the table back then. And then they don't even have the skill sets on how to balance that development. It's shameful. It's shameful. So that's what I mean. So we have this thing that's happening in urban America that is frightening, and I feel bad because, you know, mature, effective leadership or groups of people that know what they're doing doesn't exist anymore. All of these people are basically political hacks. You go and have a conversation with them, they're looking at you, well, you know, I'm like, look, man, go die. What are you talking about? What are you talking about? Do you know what you're doing or you don't? I bet you if you go, look, I know a lot of these private developers in this state.
Right.
You want to know what they really say? I'm not going to even say it online. I'm not going to even say. You know what they really say?
What is this?
Eric, if I told you what they really say, you would be shocked.
So, I don't, you know, I think we've covered.
Hey, Royston. Oh, the guy name is Jay Morrison. He's the guy that runs all around the country getting in mic and getting in dirty fields talking about, look, we got to buy back the block. Yeah. Oh, my God. That's embarrassing. I think I had that.
What's his name?
Jay Morrison.
Oh, okay.
I think I had a copy of it.
Right.
But I can't. I get so much stuff, man. I can't find. His name is Jay Morrison. Going to buy back the block. He had him in an open field on Springfield Avenue. And I don't know if anybody's been on Springfield Avenue lately. But it's pretty scary.
So there's a.
Go ahead, man. I'm sorry.
I
went on too long with that.
No, that's okay. That's okay. I said I always wanted to try to do a public service announcement.
Yeah.
Right. just to get people thinking, and so I'm going to play this one. Here we go.
Are you a mess, Eric?
Thank you.
it's a, I don't know if we're still on, but The Great Hack on Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
I saw it twice last night. You know, we, you and I knew about the micro-targeting business.
Yeah.
We've learned that a long time ago. We understand how to target various people, various groups with, you know, technically propaganda, political information that get them to go and vote or to persuade them to vote in a certain way. But now this has been globalized at a whole nother level. It's very evil in a sense. And The Great Hack is something that I'm recommending that everybody watches on Netflix if you can. I mean, if I can get it free on my site, I would, on my Facebook page. They might not let me do it, but it's The Great Hack.
Right.
And I got to tell you something. I mean, after you see it, Eric, you will really understand where we're going as a world. You'll really understand how they're using our information. And you'll really see that this whole, what we, all of this stress that we see around the world mm-hmm. is being managed in such a unique way through this technology. Facebook, Amazon, Google,
mm-hmm.
Twitter, we're in trouble.
Oh, good.
We're in cold-blooded trouble. And we got it. I want everybody to go watch it, The Great Hack. Just Shady Lathan turned me on to it, and I was up till 1 o'clock.
Well, I haven't seen it, but I've talked about this, that my career in marketing and advertising was all about engineering thinking.
Mm-hmm.
That was it. And in fact, it was the thing that got me interested in advertising and marketing. Mm-hmm. Because when I was sitting there at SVA, and we were studying the Pet Rock, and we were studying, you know, other phenomenal advertising campaigns. We were studying subliminal seduction, you know, and how they train the minds of people to purchase products, and then how the government had to step in, right? And the government's going to have to step in again. But back then, the government had to step in, Kevin, because, and I think I told this story, but if you guys, you know, study advertising and marketing, they used to be able to, companies used to be able to, at a lower frequency in the stores, play music or have subliminal messages come through the music that would tell you buy Charmin mm-hmm. or buy Coca-Cola. Mm-hmm. And you couldn't hear it with your, you know, it was your subconscious that picked it up. And all of a sudden you'd be in aisle two and you'd say, man, you know, I got to get some Charmin toilet paper. And you didn't understand why. And then the government said, wait a minute, you can't do that to people. You just can't do that to people. And so now what they're doing is they're bombarding you through data that they collect
yeah.
about you and your habits. And understand this too. Even down to your GPS, I mean, your global positioning device and going through tolls. They track
everything.
Where you travel, how long you're traveling. Now that you have XM radio, what you're listening to, right? They couldn't really track it as much.
What we thought was a tool to communicate with each other about our family is now, look, data is more valuable than oil.
It is.
Right? And this company, I know you're going to freak about Cambridge Analytical. Mm-hmm. I didn't see them as the devil. I saw them as genius. They were genius.
No, they're the devil.
No, but they are the devil. But guess what, though? But guess what, Eric? In your lifetime, I could tell you five ways that you've done what Cambridge Analytical did. I know you. I know this. I know you. Yeah. You know. We know about this.
Mm-hmm.
But it was on steroids, and how they did it was brilliant. So me, I'm like, oh, this is brilliant. I'm like, okay, now I'm seeing what they're doing. So one thing that I do believe needs to happen is that they have to be regulated in a big way. And our privacy has to be protected. But I don't even know how they I don't even know how they could go back and do it. I don't even know if they could fix it. I think that is gone. I think every time we turn on our computers, every time we do something, they got our profile. Now, the question is, does it work? Does it really work? So it's working in very, very, very poor countries, this fake propaganda that they're pushing out there through these Facebook ads. And, you know, the company Alamo that was working for Trump, mm-hmm. they spent $1 million a day going after you and me. But they narrowed it down to the persuaders, people they really could persuade. They were spending $1 million a day. And then what they were doing was doing all of this this advertising, this propaganda against Hillary and against that shit was effective. Excuse me, that stuff was effective. Of course. And you know, if you're not savvy,
right,
you would buy it.
Yeah.
Right? So they actually Brexit, what happened in with the 2016 election, mm-hmm, and what's happened in Ghana, what's happening all around the world. It's really interesting that, I mean, they went after Cambridge Analytical, but the real devil for me was Facebook, because they were giving and selling out information all over the world.
Sure.
They said they had 5,000. They were able to touch you 5,000 times or something of that. I forgot the language that they used, but it was brilliant.
It is.
I had to tell you something, man. You talking about mass control of people? Oh, come on.
Well, so to answer your question, everybody's fingerprint already out there. Your digital fingerprint is out there already. They have enough information about you that even with the intervention of government at this point,
they got it.
They already have it.
Yeah, I think it's fascinating.
Right? So what would have to happen is people would have to literally off-ramp from all technology, right? And I can't even tell you the period of time before it would correct itself, right?
Well, when you get the apps, right? I wasn't aware of this myself. When I download the apps, I really don't read all of the stuff. So they're saying what they're actually saying that they can share my messages. I don't read it.
They share your messages, they share your photos, they share your location.
Yeah.
They share all of these things.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what, you're right, Eric. And I thought it was, I mean, it's a great movie.
Now, so this is very interesting, right? Even my phone, because it's always listening. Now, technically, guys, and this just happened in real time. I didn't have my phone, but you're supposed to say, "Hey Siri,"
right,
before it.
And that capturing all
But it listened to our whole conversation, and we never hit a button.
It's called The Great Hack. Yeah. It's a great, I got to tell you, I watched it twice last night. There was another movie I watched.
So for all the people who have like Alexa, who have Google,
your monitor,
who have all your, and here's the other thing too.
I think it's fascinating.
The internet TVs.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the smart
TVs.
They're
listening.
They listen to everything you do.
They listen to everything that you do.
Right. You're absolutely right. They can turn on your phone while you have your phone.
Hey man, you know what? Go back to put aluminum foil on your head. Go back, get your transistor radio, pull your rabbit ear antennas out of the basement.
But, there's a movie. I know we're going to wrap it up. There's a movie I want everybody to watch on Stars because, Diane has gotten me off documentaries. She said, "I watched too many documentaries."
Mm-hmm.
She said, "Are you watching normal TV this week?" I said, "I'm watching normal TV." But it was this series called Mother, Father, Son with Richard Gere.
Right.
And Richard Gere plays this very interesting newspaper owner.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a backdrop to his story and about his son or whatever. But it really is about how the press can manipulate politics all around the world. And how he justified doing it. It was really interesting. But it's a story about the mother, father, and the son. But it's really about Richard Gere and his thought process about how to use the press to control, politics, control power. But he says something, one of the prime ministers that he was not agreeing with after being there for 10 years. I want to get it. The guy said, "Well, how could you do this? How could you actually, this woman is bad, right? How could you do this?" He said, "That's not my problem. My problem is to tell people what I think they're telling me."
Right. Hey, listen.
And you got his mother, father, son. It's on Stars. Guys, it's really good. It was really
good. Watch out, man. Turn those devices off.
Yeah.
Oh, brother.
I didn't really want to go in on him that. He was that shit.
So, bro. It is terrible.
It's terrible.
You know what, though, man? Listen, we have told truth. The whole truth and nothing but the truth.
Yeah.
Right? What they say it, the truth with no chaser.
Yeah, The Great Hack, man. That's England. You're going to love that. That's your cousin. I had to watch it twice because it was so brilliant. I'm like, wait a minute, these guys. I mean, and their business model was not something that was so complicated. You know, it was about accessing and utilizing information to, you know, to try to predict outcomes. Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. I think I may stop up at the fish truck. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. The world won't get no better. You gotta change it now. Just you and me.
Thanks for listening to the Eric Dawson Radio Show. Now that you've received this dose of thought-provoking information, why not put it to good use? Spread the word and turn your knowledge into action.
That's always helpful. Folks become more informed, and hopefully through the discussion, we can engage them, and then through the information, they can be empowered to make a change in the community.
Tune in regularly for more food for thought. This has been the Eric Dawson Radio Show on RTH 2000.